Good morning, everyone. I'd also like to welcome our online viewers to our service as well. I'm going to be inviting the choir up front. Our anthem today is titled, How Deep the Father's Love for Us. And this song has been a favorite of mine for many years now because of the words. So I just pray that you listen to the words of this song. It is after Easter, but it's still a very important message for us to hear year-round because the Father loves us so much. How deep the Father's love for us.
Please join me as we read Psalm 67. It can be found in your hymnals on page 791. We'll read it together. O God, be gracious to us and bless us, and make your face to shine upon us. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you.
Let the nations go glad and sing for joy.
praise you, O God, let all the peoples praise you.
May your presence and your greatness increase. God, our God, has blessed us.
God has blessed us.
Let all nations fear your God.
Thank you.
I invite you to again stand with us and sing our hymn here this morning, The Church is One Foundation.
Alexandrian by birth, and an eloquent man came to Ephesus, and he was mighty in the scriptures. The man had been instructed in the way of the Lord, and being fervent in spirit, he was speaking and teaching accurately the things concerning Jesus, being acquainted only with the baptism of John. And he began to speak out boldly in the synagogue. And when Priscilla and Aquila heard him, they took him aside and explained to him the way of God more accurately. When he wanted to go across to Achaia, the brethren encouraged them and wrote to the disciples to welcome him. And when he had arrived, he helped greatly those who had believed through grace. For he powerfully refuted the Jews in public, demonstrating by the scriptures that Jesus was the Christ.
Thank you. You may be seated. Well, certainly, as you know, we live in a divided world. Seems like we're divided along racial lines, economic lines, political ideologies. There's a lot of divisions in this world. And at least, there's no divisions within the church, right? So that's sort of tongue-in-cheek. Yeah, I mean, some of you get that. I mean, there's a church is divided as well. And you may have heard, or if you haven't seen the letter that went out this past Wednesday that I wrote, there is a new Methodist denomination called the Global Methodist Church. I'm not going to say much about that this morning, but I am writing about that, and so I urge you to take a look so you know what's going on. Take a look at those letters that go out via email. If you don't have email, just let me know, and we'll be glad to make copies of those letters and make sure you get those as well. Okay. So I want to talk about unity today, and what I think unity really means, and how we can achieve it as well. The first point, I know you know, but I want to stress how important this is to God. The first point is this: unity, right, is desired by God. God wants unity, and he wants unity in his church as well. So unity is this thing that's desired by God. And so, get the right passage here. So when Jesus, right before Jesus went to the cross, he prayed a prayer to God. It's recorded in John chapter 17. Okay. And it shows that unity is not just a nice to have thing. You know, in other words, there's some churches that focus more on social justice, and we need to free the oppressed, and we need to do that, and unity would be a nice thing to have. There's other churches that focus a whole lot on, no, evangelism, we need to bring people into the kingdom of God, and unity would be a nice thing to have. That's not how God looks at it. He looks at it as an essential thing. Because here is Jesus, he's getting ready to go to the cross, and he's praying. He prays for three things: himself, his disciples, and as he says in verse 20, I ask not only on behalf of these, but also on behalf of those who will believe in me through their word. Well, who believes in the disciples because of their what the disciples said? Well, eventually that's us. So he's praying for us as well. And he can pray for a lot of things when he's praying for the church of 2022, right? He could pray for a lot of things. He could pray that we work hard to free the oppressed. He could pray that we bring a whole bunch of people into the kingdom of God. But listen to what he prays for. Verse 21. He prays that they may all be one. So he prays that we may be one. As you, Father, are me, and I am you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. Because when we're united, that's really going to get the world's attention. Why? I said it in the beginning. The world's a divided place. Right? So this is not new, though. Divided churches are certainly not new. We go back to the church in Corinth. Paul wrote to this church in Corinth. Listen, he has a problem with this church. He writes beginning in 3:1, 1 Corinthians 3:1, "And so, brothers and sisters, I cannot speak to you as spiritual people, but rather as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ." He says you're not mature Christians, is what he's saying. "I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you were not ready for solid food. Even now you are still not ready." And then he gives a reason. "For you are still in the flesh. For as long as there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not of the flesh and behaving according to human inclinations?" He says you haven't grown up in the faith because you're still fighting with each other. He says this isn't right. And they were fighting over personalities. Verse 4. "For when one says, I belong to Paul, and another, I belong to Apollos, are you not merely human?" In fact, if we go back a page or a couple chapters to 1 Corinthians 1:12, he gives two other groups. Yeah, there's the Apollos group. I belong to Apollos. I belong to Paul. He also says there's a group that says, I belong to Cephas. That would be Peter. And there's a third group that says, I belong to Jesus. Oh, wait a minute. That sounds really good, right? I want to be in the last group that says, I belong to Jesus, except for one thing. Paul has a problem with that group as well. Probably because they were saying, we don't need to listen to all those other people and what that. We're better than they are. I think that's what the Jesus group was saying. We're better than the rest of them. They were separating themselves from everybody else in this way that sounds so pious and sounds so good. And we see that today. We get separated by personalities. We get separated by personalities. All you got to do is probably get three, maybe at most four people in a room and just say the name Donald Trump. Boom! And instantly, you know, you'll just get, you know, all this stuff, you know? And that's what happens. And I think God, you know, I don't think God's as concerned about our differences as he is about how we treat one another. And guess what he's really concerned about? Brings me to my next point about unity. How do we achieve unity? Unity comes from focusing on one purpose, having the same purpose. After 9/11, you know, so many people have commented that right after 9/11 happened, we were united as a country. Why? Because we had a common purpose. We had a common enemy, right? So how united is the world as the country today? Not at all. Because we've forgotten that there's still common enemies out there, right? And we've forgotten that. We've broken down into our little cliques. And all of that. But the way to overcome that is when we all focus on God, right? And what God's doing. So Paul continues in 1 Corinthians 3, starting in verse 5. What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Now when I read this, just listen about where God is in this. It's all about God. What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you came to believe as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but it was God who gave the growth. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. The one who plants and the one who waters have a common purpose, right? Same purpose. and each will receive wages according to the labor of each. For we are God's servants working together. You're God's field, God's building. When we all focus on what God is doing. John Wesley gave a sermon back in his ministry days in the 1700s called Catholic Spirit. And immediately we went, oh, wait, what? Catholic Spirit? No. We don't understand what that means. Catholic is just a word that means universal. You know, and even today, if you look in our hymnal, you know, when we do the Apostles' Creed and we both say we believe in the Holy Catholic Church, we don't believe in the Roman Catholic Church. In fact, in the hymnal, there's a little asterisk there. If you go to the asterisk, it says belief in universal. Okay. So John Wesley's talking about this universal spirit we should have amongst us. And he goes to the Old Testament, an Old Testament story, to make the point, as it says there, that if your heart is like my heart, then give me your hand. And he says, what does that mean that our hearts are alike? He says, first of all, this is what it doesn't mean. We have the same opinion on things. We don't have to have the same opinion on things. That's, by the way, where the country is right now. If you don't have my opinion, get away from me. You know? The second thing it doesn't mean is we have to worship the same. We don't have to worship the same. But what does it mean to have the same heart? It means our hearts are both right with God. It means we both focus on God and love God. That's what it means. And if our hearts are together, then give me your hand. Give me your hand. Then it doesn't matter, even if we think differently, even if we're different political parties, we can love together, we can pray together, we can serve together. Right? That's what he's saying. So we need to recognize that other people different than us, they love God too. We're not the only ones. They love God as well. So I have a little confession to make. Here's my confession, that about 5 miles to the west of here, 4 or 5 miles, I don't know, there's another United Methodist Church. Mount Calvary United Methodist Church on Fairville Avenue. And several years ago, they opened a thrift store on right on 22, Wonders Found, a ministry of Mount Calvary United Methodist Church. My confession, I was a little jealous. Wait, there's a couple thousand cars a day that pass by that place, you know? And they're getting all that focus. What about us? Whiny voice going, and no, what about us? It doesn't matter about us. It's about God, right? But sometimes we get so closed off, and we forget they're doing a good work for God. All the money that from the thrift store Wonders Found goes towards missions. They go on mission trips. They fund a ministry in Belize. They do all this stuff, right? That's good. Here's how we work together. Of course, we have a ministry hub. We have a Mission Central hub, right? They get in medical equipment. They can't sell medical equipment. They give it to us. Typically, Carol takes that, and we send it to Mission Central. Some we use locally, but we use it, and so we're supporting each other. Oh, wait, we might not get the credit for it. Nobody may know it's St. John's Church. Who cares? As long as God gets the glory. It's all about focusing on what God is doing, right? Focusing on what God is doing. That's how we have unity. We focus on what God is doing. We also have unity when we recognize that other people do certain things better than we do. And we're glad about it. We're not upset. We're glad about it. You know, we recognize that. So in the story in Acts, we have Apollos. You know, here's Paul is doing his ministry thing. He's going around, right? He has some people like Priscilla and Aquila. They're also going around. And all of a sudden, this Apollos guy shows up. show up this Johnny come lately, you know? And I almost have to sort of wonder, I would probably feel this way, if I was like in Paul's position, here's the problem. This Apollos guy, he's a really good speaker. People love his sermons. And Paul even admits in some of his letters, I'm not a good speaker. I'm not eloquent. Apollos is eloquent. I'd almost be tempted, how can we push him away a little bit? But that's not what they do, because it's not about Paul. It's not about Priscilla and Aquila. It's about God. Let's bring him in. Let's use him. And he was used in a powerful way, because they were fine that somebody else could do something they couldn't do. They're glad about that. They're glad about that. So let me continue on 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Because Paul then talks about what we're building, and people doing some things and other people doing other things better. According to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation and someone else is building on it. Each builder must choose with care how to build on it. No one can lay any foundation other than the one that has been laid, and that foundation is Jesus Christ. It's all about Jesus, right? Now, if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, straw, or with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, or straw. I think, you know, when we build, sometimes our work is better than others. Sometimes our work will last farther into eternity than others, right? Depending on what we do and how well we do it. So that's the difference between gold and straw, right? The work of each builder will become visible, for the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each has done. If what has been built on the foundation survives, the builder will receive a reward. So if what we do is we do it well, we're going to get rewarded for that. If the work is burned up, in other words, we didn't do it well, the builder will suffer loss. We're the ones who are going to suffer the loss. The builder will be saved. He said, don't worry, you're still going to heaven, don't worry. The builder will be saved, but only as through fire. Wow. I mean, Paul says, like, yeah, you're saved, but sort of barely. I know, we're saved by believing in Jesus Christ. It's not barely saved, but it's like some people just do the bare minimum to get in. He's urging us to say, no, some people have gifts, and you know, what they build and is gold is different than what you build as gold. And what they build as gold might get them more attention than what you build as gold. But it's okay, we got to do that. And if we try to do what we're not good at, it's going to be wood or hay or straw. And it's not going to last. We're not going to get the reward. And we don't want to be those, you know. We don't want to be the one who will certainly be saved, but only as through fire, right? Barely. So let me, with all that said about unity, let me ask a question, a couple questions. One question is this. Will Methodism be united? Will Methodism be united? I say the question like this because I think this is a different question than to ask this question. Will the United Methodist Church split? It's a different question. And by the way, I really don't want to say this, but I have to say this. Will the United Methodist Church split? I think it's almost guaranteed to. In fact, it's already started to happen in a very small way. I mean, the first fissures, the cracks are there. But here's the point. What that looks like, I have no idea, but it, regardless of that, you know, whatever it looks like, can we still be united? You see, I don't think if there's two denominations rather than one denomination, that does not mean, oh, we totally failed. No, we can still be united. Look, I mean, we have all kinds of other denominations around here. We go to Lent services at Faith, at Shell's, right? And we do those things, and there's a unity amongst the people there, between us and them. But my hope and my prayer is, and I hope you'll pray for this too, is that when this split comes, this big split will split, don't know, when it comes, that we can do it in a way that will be amicable, that will be friendly. Other denominations have been through this, and honestly, in other denominations, it's gotten ugly because it's ended up in the courts. Why? Because both sides have sued each other about who gets to keep this property or those assets or this or that, right? I don't want that to happen, church. We love it too much. And I hope we can do it differently. I really do. So just keep that in prayer. Just keep our United Methodist Church in prayer as we go through that. And I'll be writing more about that. You'll see that in the midweek letters as well. John Wesley said, "If your heart is like my heart, then give me your hand. That's all we require." Right? May that be true of us every day. That if somebody else loves God, yeah, we can be with them, we can work with them. Father God, indeed, this is tough. And we don't like to even think about what may happen. But it's probably going to happen. But no matter what happens, dear Lord, may we always remember that there are Christians who we disagree with who love you just as much as we love you. And may we always be willing to love them, to pray with them, to serve with them as well. Father, may we not make any of this about ourselves, but may it all be about you, giving you the glory, bringing us together, because we all love you for your glory. Amen.
Your glory to
Amen. Let there be peace on earth.